Today we have the closeout presentation from the extension of ELSA. It will be in two parts. One is about the simulator, which is now open source, reusable, and so forth. The simulator is quite different from what we used to. It's a fast time simulator, but it's quite an abstract idea. And we will show then in the second part some ways of how to use it, how to model new concept with this simulator. So the presentation will be given by Marco first, from Deep Blue, and then we will have Salvatore from the University of Palermo showing what can be done with this simulator. Floor is yours.
Thank you, Mark. So welcome everyone, thank you for coming, and I want to say good morning also to people connected from Brussels. So we start right away. This is the outline of this presentation, so what we are going to see in this hour. So I'm going to start with a bit of an introduction about the first phase of the project, so which were the motivations behind the extension and its objectives. Then a high-level description of the air traffic simulator we have developed during this extension. And at the end, Salvatore will show you some results we have obtained so far. The first phase of the project was carried out by a consortium made up by Deep Blue, University of Palermo, and Scuola Normale Superiore di Pisa. While for this extension, there were only us, Deep Blue, and University of Palermo, because we decided to concentrate only on specific parts of the previous phase of the project, so the other partners were not interested in going further. So a few words about the main ELSA, let's say. So the first phase of the project moved from the understanding that new methods, new techniques coming from the complex system science might be useful to analyze some of the emerging characteristics of the ATM, looking at the whole ATM at system level. So to try to answer to these research problems, the project had three main objectives. The first one was to characterize the ATM system in terms of some statistical regularities, and the output of this work was a set of what we called best analysis, so five ways in which you can analyze in a novel way the ATM system. The second objective was to try to simulate the same regularities observed in the current scenario in the CESAR scenario using an agent-based model. Third objective was to develop a decision support tool, or at least a prototype of it, that was using the information coming from the previous activities. So essentially the first and the third objective were achieved to an adequate extent, while for the second one, essentially we completed the modeling part in the current scenario satisfactorily, but we weren't able to model the CESAR scenario, so to carry out simulation in the CESAR scenario. And in addition, there were two main limitations of the model we had at the end of the first phase of the project. First of all, the model was taking only a single sector, so it was able to work only at sector level, so quite small area. And it was using as a reference a real sector. It has been calibrated on that specific sector in the Rome ACC, so it wasn't able to be extended to other use cases. Given this limitation, we applied for the extension and we started the extension with these objectives. The first of them was to model completely the CESAR scenario, or at least some of the features foreseen in the step one of CESAR. Second objective was to extend the model, so enlarge its spatial scale, so make the model able to work at least at ACC level, and even more if possible. Then third objective was to perform some capacity stress tests, so try to increase the number of aircraft simultaneously present in the area in order to see what was happening in the current and in the CESAR scenario. And last but not least, to make this simulator portable, make it a tool to be used by the ATM research community. Not only by us, because before it was kind of difficult to work with this simulator, but we put a lot of effort in making it usable by other people. The workflow was pretty simple, given the simple objectives we had, so there was a bit of data analysis to support the development of the model. And the development of the portable version followed, of course, the model development. So it was a flow in this direction. And of course, validation ensured during all the project life cycle for the model development that we were actually modeling the right things in the right way. And for the portable version that we were addressing in the right way the user needs. And this is the output. So this is an overview of the simulator we have developed. It's a modular simulator, so each of these modules can be used separately. It's an en route simulator, so it works above flight level 240. Now, in the following, I will give you some details of each of these modules to let you understand what the simulator is able to do. Before starting, a few words about the development process. For the model itself, what has started in the first phase of the project, we did not follow what is the classical software development path because it was kind of subsequent additions following the results that we were obtaining. So trying to step by step being able to correctly simulate the current and the CSR scenario by comparing the results of the current scenario with real data and of the CSR scenario with expert feedback. While for the portable version, we used a more structured user-centered approach. So we first identified target user, which were essentially researchers in the ATM field. Then with them, we try to identify scenarios of use and potential requirements. Following these requirements, we started the work of implementation in the simulator. Then the final version of the model was sent again to the users to evaluate them. And this was followed by a final redesign to get the final version. Let's start with having an overview of the simulator. So we start from the left side, so the network generator, which is the first module. This is used to essentially build up the airspace. Every module is pretty customizable. In this case, for example, the user can build the airspace by using external data, so by feeding the module with real sectors, real navigation point network. Or the user can build a completely random network of sectors and navigation points using some specific methods, like this Voronoi tessellation that is cited here. This can be used to do any kind of analysis, testing new configurations of the airspace, for example. But as said, it's fully customizable. The user can use only some of these features if needed. Once the airspace is constructed, this is fed into these two modules, the traffic generator and the strategic layer. They are essentially the same thing. The traffic generator is a simplified version of the strategic layer, and they are both used to define the planned trajectories, essentially. So the traffic generator, which is the simpler version, essentially allows the user to define the trajectories by specifying either a total number of flights or a distribution of flights per entry exit point of the area under consideration, and to specify capacities of the different sector. And this module automatically builds the trajectory, making sure that sector capacity is not overloaded. If the traffic generator is too simple and the user wants something more complex, let's say more similar to reality, there is the strategic layer that was developed during the first phase of the project, but that we integrated in this simulator during the extension. And essentially here, the other things that the user can define are departure waves from airports, but since this is an en route simulator, departure waves are referred to still to entry exit points in the area under consideration. Plus, the user can also define different cost functions for the airlines. The cost function we are using has this form written here, so there are essentially two terms. One which is weighting the length of the trajectory, and the other which is weighting the shift in time with respect to the preferred time of departure, which is this T0. Essentially, you can model here kind of low-cost companies, where alpha is greater than beta, so these are companies which prefer to keep the length as planned to save fuel, for example, but they don't care about shifting in time because they don't have to respect connections. And you can have more traditional companies where they might prefer to change the route instead of shifting in time. So this is what can be done with this strategic layer. Once the trajectories, the planned trajectories are defined, this can go into the more tactical part of the model, which is on the right side of this slide. Of course, if the user has its own planned trajectories, they can be used instead of using all the other models I have explained you so far. The first thing that can be done with this plant trajectory is using this rectification module. And this is what we used to model one of the features of the CSR scenario, so the straighter trajectories between origin and destination. This module allows the user to go continuously from the current scenario to a CSR scenario where the trajectory is fully straight between origin and destination. Essentially, the efficiency is defined as the ratio between the actual distance followed by the aircraft and the best path. With this procedure, trajectories can be made progressively straighter, defining a specific value of this efficiency. Then, after having rectified trajectories or not, depending on the needs, this can be inserted into the tactical layer, which in this schema is the same size of the other modules, but it's kind of more complex and huge. So what is this tactical layer? It is essentially a conflict resolution engine. In the model, there is a controller, which is a kind of super controller, we can say, because it's able to deconflict all flights. So no conflicts ever occur. So there are no conflicts at all. But this controller has some limitations. The first of them is a limited look ahead. So the user can set the look ahead of the controller. This means that the controller is able to see only within its look ahead. So beyond that, there might be other conflicts or his actions can trigger other conflicts in the future. Then the forecast of the controller can be perturbed, adding noise to the speed of the aircraft. So in this way, the forecast will not be perfect and noise can be added according to the needs, depending on the scenario the user wants to simulate. Then it is possible to activate what we call the shocked areas. So areas which are forbidden to aircraft. And these are representing essentially weather events or military areas. And these, of course, can be set, we will see in the following, by specifying location, flight level, and the time of duration, and so on. And finally, the last capability of this module is to make the planned trajectories conflict-free. So to have, at the beginning of the simulation, of the fast-time simulation, conflict-free trajectories. And this is simulating also enhanced information sharing, where essentially every trajectory is shared and global optimization can be achieved before actually having all the flights in the air. A few more details about this module. Essentially, it works with two different time steps. The first one, on the upright corner, delta t, 10 minutes, is the look ahead of the controller, which here is 10 minutes, but of course can be set, which is the longer time step. And then there's a shorter time step, that here is 8 seconds, which is the time step at which the trajectory is sampled. So every 8 seconds, the models check for conflicts in the airspace. Of course, the look ahead of the controller, this bigger time step of 10 minutes. These are not consecutive, but are overlapping of a certain quantity that can be set. In terms of conflict detection, this is done by putting all aircraft in a list. The first aircraft is checked against all the others every 8 second time step. After being checked, the list is shuffled in order not to having the same aircraft moving to avoid conflicts. But in this way, there is not always the same aircraft with the need of changing trajectory in case of conflict. The conflict resolution instead can be done by either rerouting. So in this case, if you consider the planned trajectory going straight from the entrance of this sector to the exit, considering that there is an area here that is forbidden, either because it's a weather event or because there's a conflict. So the model defines a new temporary navigation point and deviate the trajectory to this new point. And then the aircraft comes back to the planned trajectory, making sure that the angles of deviation are lower than a specified threshold that can be set. And if the re-entry point cannot be achieved, it's moved forward up to the exit point of the sector or of the ACC. If rerouting is not possible, the model tries to change the flight level, either going up or down of more than one flight level if the flight level immediately above is already occupied. The third strategy is to issue directs. So essentially, as soon as the aircraft enters the area under control, with a probability that can be set, a direct can be given to the aircraft to reach the destination or the exit point with a shorter path. And this is selected to be the optimal direct possible. Here you can see what can the user set in terms of shocks. Essentially, these shocks that here are marked with these red dots, while the blue one are all the possible navigation points in the area. Shocks can be set by defining their position, their flight level, their duration, so essentially are kind of fully customizable. Okay, that's it on the model. In terms of portability, what we did to make it really portable and usable. This simulator is fully open source, so it can be freely downloaded and used. It is therefore released under an open source license and can be found at this link, which is a quite known repository called GitHub, which we decided to use because it offers a lot of tools to effectively collaborate with people on using any kind of software. There's a wiki, there's an issue tracker, so people can make a branch of the software, make modification, and then ask the developer to check. It's very useful if people want to collaborate. What are the prerequisites for using this simulator? Essentially, the simulator is written in Python. Python should be enough, in fact, to use this simulator, because even for the tactical layer, which is written in C, we developed an interface in Python. Knowing Python, it's enough for basic usage, plus some knowledge of Unix commands. Of course, if the user wants to go much in depth, let's say, then and more detailed knowledge of C and Python is needed to modify the different modules. What we give as support, what we developed as support, all this is available on the GitHub repository. So there's an install guide, there's some basic documentation, which we are planning to update and we will update in the future. There's a user guide with some examples and tutorials, and I will show them in the following slide. And there are some unit tests that can be used to check if the software is working properly when a modification is done. As part of the user guide, we developed three tutorials, which are essentially guiding the user step by step in doing something specific. The first one allows the user to plug in a customized shocks module. So if someone, for example, has developed its own weather model and wants to use it in the simulator to check how it works, this can be done, and it's explained in this tutorial how to do it. If the user has its own airspace generator and wants to put it into the model, the second tutorial explained how to do it. The third one, if the user wants to customize the conflict resolution procedure, so changing the controlling parameters in the different areas of the airspace, in each sector, in each ACC or whatever. This is it for the model, and I leave the floor to Salvatore.
I will try to explain now some possible results that can be achieved by using this model. First of all, I want to show you what are the parameters, the three parameters into this model. In the third column, we have a description of these parameters, and on the fourth column, we have added a column saying something more on the way we can use these parameters. For example, you can see that we have a set of parameters that we label with FP, which according to the legend we have below, is a free parameter. These are free parameters of the model in the sense that they can be freely chosen by the users according to the type of simulations they want to perform. There is the capital delta T, which is the look ahead parameter, for example, that can be set to 20 minutes, 10 minutes, 40 minutes. This is the range of time for the capital delta T parameter, which is appropriate for this model. We have a small delta T, which is the length of the elementary time interval. It controls the frequency by which the trajectory are sampled. And you can see these are examples of parameters that can be freely chosen by the user according to his experience and the type of simulation they want to do. Then we have another set of parameters which we label with CD, which according to the legend below means parameters that can be calibrated from data. For example, the typical parameter we try to calibrate from data is the velocity of the aircraft. We have a velocity distribution and we can put this information into our model without any problem. Or PD, which is the probability of issuing directs, for example. At a certain time step, the controller, the aircraft controller, can check whether or not it is possible to issue a direct in order to make shorter the trajectory of the aircraft, and this is done according with this probability, which is called PD, and this is again another parameter that can be calibrated from data. All the parameters related to shocks can be calibrated from data if one wants to do this, and if one has data about weather events, for example, one can choose the location of the shocks, the duration of the shocks, the extension of the shocks. These are all parameters that can be calibrated from data and put into the model.
Sorry, did you tell us what shocks were? Did I miss?
Weather events or military areas.
Okay. Not conflicts between aircraft, are they shocks?
Well, the way the model treats conflicts and weather events is the same, because essentially the controller has to do the same thing, which is avoiding this area where there is in general a problem. This problem may be either a conflict with another aircraft or a weather event. Okay. Of course, the conflicts come from the interaction between trajectories. Weather events are some external inputs that can be put into the model. Then we have a third kind of parameters that we call CV, which means calibration validation. In the sense, these are parameters for which it's not only possible a calibration from data, but it is also possible to set these parameters according to a validation procedure that we have done during the ELSA project with CESAR experts or with aircraft controllers that we interviewed working in the Ciampino ACC in Rome. Typical example is this parameter number 7, alpha m. This is the angle of deviation between the planned trajectory and the modified trajectory. So we asked this guy, but do you have an idea, if a controller has to modify a trajectory, what is the typical angle between the planned and modified trajectory? And they said, okay, 10 degrees is enough, some case in 15 is another possible thing, no more than 20 degrees. So these are parameters which are hard to evaluate directly from data. And then we tried to ask controllers working on day by day on these kind of things to ask what is their view about these parameters. So these are the CV, what we call CV parameters. I'm reporting these parameters into this table here. These are the typical values that we have used in our simulations. Another way to look at these parameters, which is important from my point of view as a physicist and as a person who has to develop the model, these are parameters that can allow the model to have a large heterogeneity. We are constructing an agent-based model in which the agents are not the same. They are different with each other, and these parameters allow me to set up these differences among agents. For example, the CV parameters, the one that can be calibrated according to the views of the operational people, the controllers, these are parameters that try to catch the behavior of the controllers. These alpha M, for example, these LS, which is the sensitivity when we issue the direct, these Tmax, which is the maximum time after which the controllers try to put back the aircraft on its own planned trajectory, these are parameters that can vary from an ICC to another ICC, and in somehow they try to catch how, what is the typical way controllers work into a certain ACC. Then in the model we have, as we said before, all these other parameters that can be calibrated from data, and another way to look at these parameters, for example the aircraft velocity, origin and destination pairs, flight level, these are the distributions of these velocity, origin, destination pairs and flight levels that we took from the DDR data, and these are parameters that allow me to introduce heterogeneity from the side of the aircraft, which are the other typical agent in the model. So we have these two sets of parameters that can make the model fully heterogeneous, which is, we believe, an advantage, because we can catch different situations according to the different ACCs, so we can describe different things, because we have the flexibility into the parameters to do that.
We will show in this video a simulation relative to the LIRR ACC that covers most of the Italian airspace. The thick black lines you see in the upper part of the video are the northern borders of the ACC. The grey lines are the planned flight trajectories as extracted from the M1 DDR files relative to day 6th of May 2010. The aircraft are represented by a point to which we associate three features. First, a number indicating the flight level. Each flight level has a different color. Second, a circle of radius equal to 5 nautical miles, which is the safety threshold we usually consider in the model. Third, a small thick circle, which is used to further indicate all aircraft flying a flight level 250. Starting from time 12 hours 44 minutes, one can see two aircraft flying at flight level 260 that are possibly incurring in a safety event. The first aircraft is the one visible on the top left side of the screen. In this case, it is rerouted in a way such that it follows a new trajectory on the right of the planned one. It leaves the ACC at time 13 hours 3 minutes. The second aircraft is the one that follows an orthogonal south-north trajectory. It leaves the ACC at time 12 hours 58 minutes, having followed its planned trajectory without any modification.
This and the second one, the one I will show just in a few minutes, is what we believe the most important slide, the most important results in this model. What are these three plots? Let's start with the one on the top left slide. These are the average number of conflicts that we can observe by running the model. On the x-axis, we have these values of efficiency. The efficiency, you remember, is the parameters that can give me an information about how rectified are the trajectories. If we look in this part of the region, we have essentially the first point is the efficiency in the current scenario for a certain ACC, which is the Rome ACC, the LIR ACC. And then, varying this efficiency, we can go to the Cesar scenario, which is this value up here, which is essentially 1. By using this rectifying procedure, we can check in a controlled way, because we have each step, we have each value of efficiency, what happens going from the current scenario to the Cesar scenario. And the specific metric we are using here is the number of actions that are performed by the average number of conflicts that are detected in the model. As you can see, this is a good picture because we can see that the average number of conflicts in the current scenario is larger than the number of conflicts in the Cesar scenario, which goes in the direction that the Cesar scenario should perform better. Another important result is that in this figure you see the superposition of different curves. Each of these curves is obtained by using a different number of aircraft in the sector. We go from 1,500 aircraft to 2,200 aircraft in AIRA. You can see two things. First of all, the result I was mentioning before is robust in the sense that even if I increase the number of aircraft, still the number of conflicts is going down. The other important point is that, as you can see in the legend, this is the average number of conflicts normalized with the square of the number of aircraft. If I do this normalization, all the curves collapse into a single one. So this is a scaling relation that tells me how the model performs when I increase the number of aircraft. And this is an important information because it tells me that I can do kind of prevision of what happens if I increase the capacity in my ACC. The reason for choosing this scaling factor, nf squared, is very simple in a sense, because if I have n aircraft, the possible number of conflicts is just n by n, which is nf squared. That's one result which we believe is okay, which is good, but this is obtained for the realized trajectories. I used here M3 to label the fact that these are the not the planned trajectory, but the realized trajectory, the ones where the tactical layer is working, all conflict are solved, and all the features that Marco has shown you before. My question now is, okay, we are showing that the number of conflicts is going down, but go now to the panel on the right. What should we expect in this SR scenario? And here, we made a similar analysis starting from M1. M1, M3 is resembling the R data. So M1 is the planned data, M3 is the realized trajectory. And here, in this panel, we went to see the possible safety events. PSE stands for possible safety events. Again, we normalized with the squared of the number of aircraft. And again, we find this scaling procedure showing that when we increase the number of aircraft, essentially the model still performs well. And you can see that also when we start from the planned trajectories, we have a decrease of the possible safety events going from the current scenario to this SR scenario. But you can see that the slope of these two curves is different. And if we go to this third panel here, we have put on the x-axis the possible safety events in the M1 files, on the y-axis the results from this panel. We have done a scatter plot, and we have this color code that tells we that red is for low efficiency values, which means current scenario, and blue is for high efficiency values, which are in this region, which means SESAR scenario. So how do we read this plot? We read this plot in a way that maybe is not so good as we would like to have, in the sense that when we are in the current scenario, so these red points here, this curve is almost flattish, which means that a small deviation, a deviation in the planned trajectories here, doesn't give any big result in the realized trajectories. While if we are in the SESAR scenario, close to the SESAR scenario, even if we have a small change in the planning of the trajectories, since now this curve is much steeper than here, it means that a small modification on the x-axis, planned trajectories, gives you a large modification in the realized trajectories, which means that probably in the current scenario you have many more conflicts than this SR scenario, but somehow the current scenario seems to be more flexible in changes, while this SR scenario is a bit more rigid in a sense. But there is also another important feature. The panel on the left describes the current scenario, and the panel on the right describes the SESAR scenario. You can see we have an efficiency value of 0.97, which is the typical value for the Rome ACC, and we have an efficiency value close to 1 in the other panel. And in this panel, we are plotting where the actions of the controller are located. You can see that in the current scenario, even though there is a larger number of possible conflicts or possible safety events, these are more concentrated along certain lines, which essentially are resembling the route structure, the navigation point structure of the current scenario. While on the SESAR scenario, even though there is a smaller number of possible safety events, they are more spread all over the ACC. So this is not bad in principle, it's a matter of fact, but what this picture tells us is that going from the current to the SESAR scenario, there probably, if we believe to this kind of results, probably there will be a different way by which the controllers have to work. Because now controllers are used to focus on a certain point, on a certain specific area of the airspace, and they make all the management and adjustments. But in the SESAR scenario, they will have to have a larger vision. They have to take into account larger portions of the airspace, although they will work with less conflicts. So it's a kind of balance between the two things, and then maybe this will involve a new training for the controllers and things like that. And we believe this is important. We try to see how can we remain in the CSR scenario, but take with us some of the big, important, nice features of the current scenario. The title of this slide is Role of the Look-Ahead. We have seen before that in the CSR scenario, the number of conflicts is going to decrease, but the actions will be more spread on the ACC. We have done a few experiments playing with the model parameters, and the panel on the left describes a situation in which we have a low look ahead from the controllers, 15 minutes, while on the right panel we try to increase the look ahead of the controllers, and we went up to 40 minutes. And these are preliminary results because they are obtained still in the current scenario, maybe with a larger efficiency, but not with efficiency one. This is not the CSR scenario anyway. But what this picture tells us is that maybe increasing the look ahead of the controller will help in making this possible safety events more localized, and so increasing the look ahead, maybe we can have a situation in which the number of the conflicts goes down and still they are not spread all over the ACC as we have seen in the previous picture. But I want to remark this is a preliminary in the sense that we are still working on this and making the necessary adjustments for the model. But it tells us that maybe this is the direction where we want to go, to increase the look ahead of the controller, which in a way is a reasonable thing to imagine. Another feature that may be important in the model is the role of the capacity constraints. As Marco said, the model is working at the level of an ACC, although things can be further generalized and go to a level of a national airspace or what else. Of course, each sector inside an ACC has its own capacity. And of course, this affects the way the management can be done. So we have done two experiments here, one in the current scenario and one in the CSR scenario, to see what is the role of the sector capacities in both cases. Maybe we can look at the red curve in both cases is the situation in which we don't have capacities. This is an ideal situation in which we assume that all sectors have infinite capacity. And then we have the blue curve in which we instead assume that we have capacities. The situation with no capacity was done essentially thinking that in the CSR scenario the role of the sector might be less important than in the current scenario. So we wanted to see what happens in this idealized situation in which there is no constraint, the aircraft can freely go from one side to the other without taking into account these capacities. You see, this is the number of actions. We are plotting here the number of actions as a function of the number of flights. You can see that increasing the number of flights, the number of actions is increasing with a law which is the quadratic law we have seen already in the first two pictures. So when we have no capacity, we here have the explanation of this n squared factor we have used before. But the point is that here, when we include capacity constraints into our model, this n squared law is no longer working. For example, in the CSR scenario, rather than having an n squared scaling law, the exponent of this scaling law goes up to 2.5. So capacity is making something in our model. And there are possible interpretation of this result, because maybe the capacity constraint help to spread the flights all over the ACC, so that the time concentration of the flights will decrease during peak hours, so the number of potential conflict will also decrease. This is our interpretation of this result, and this goes again in the direction that capacity constraints might be a tool, a way to keep reducing the number of possible conflicts, even in this CSR scenario. That's the lesson we learn from this kind of simulation experiments. Essentially, that's all I wanted to say for this SR scenario. We can summarize the results saying that we have a safety improvement because we have a reduction of the total number of conflicts and then a reduction of the controller workload, although we have seen that they will have probably to change the way they work because they will have to monitor a larger portion of the airspace. The other item we wanted to emphasize is that we can have an improved airspace management by increasing the look ahead of the controllers. There is still one thing that I want to show you very briefly, which regards the possible application of this model still in the current scenario. We are working on a new metric that we called FORC. We are still working now, we are writing a paper on this metric. This is a non-conventional metric that allows you to track the behavior of the controller. And this is very simple because it is duration. You suppose you have a planet trajectory. At a certain point, for some reason, either because of a conflict or because of a direct or what else, the navigation point Q is not flown by and the trajectory is modified to the red one. So the initial trajectory segment from Q to the other navigation point is replaced by a segment going from P to the other navigation point. And essentially, fork is the duration between the number of flights that are actually flying over P and not over Q, and the number of flights that were supposed by the M1 flight plans to fly over P and Q. This is a simple metric that helps capturing the differences between the planned and modified trajectories. The only thing I want to show you is this picture, in which on the x-axis we have the number of active flights during a day, and on the x-axis we have this fork metric. The different colors refer to different portions of the day. T0 is the first 8 hours of the day, T8 is the central part of the day from 8 to 16, and then T16 is the last part of the day up to midnight. The different symbols, color symbols, refer to the real data when you have circles, and results obtained by running the agent-based model in the current scenario, which are these triangles. You can see that even for this simple, very, very, very simple metric, there is a very good agreement between real data and the data simulated with the model. We are working on it in these weeks. We hope to have a paper ready by the end of this year. Meaning that if this agreement is so good between real data and the model, then the model can also be used in the current scenario to perform some policy experiments to see what changes if I move one parameter from one value to another and things like that. We find a good agreement between real data and the agent-based model when we look at this fork metric. So, since this fork metric is a metric that helps us in understanding how controllers do when they modify trajectories, we think that this is maybe useful to track the controller's behavior and see how their management might be improved by changing one parameter or the other. And essentially, this is all I wanted to say. I will skip this because we are already late. And I leave again the floor to Marco for the final conclusion.
Well, just to say that the project is over, of course, and we are here to present our findings. But our next steps will be devoted to exploit what we achieved so far. First, we would like to build a community around this simulator, involving the users that have helped us in developing the portable version, and possibly extending this community, making a group of people working with not only our simulator necessarily, but maybe agent-based modeling in general. And of course, disseminate project results. So we have a paper in preparation for next season. Will be submitted before next week.
We're extending the submission deadline, by the way.
Oh, okay. Good to know. We are writing also a paper on the air traffic simulator, which will be used as a reference for everyone using the model. We are also working on a paper more specifically on the tactical layer, so on the conflict resolution engine and the results obtained using it. Plus this paper on so-called adaptive air traffic network. This is the title, but it refers to using the strategic layer of the model. Plus, there are other two papers, which comes more from the work done in the first phase of the project. First about analysis regarding the 2010 volcano eruption, so data analysis of that period of time, plus a paper on non-conventional metrics. It refers to what Salvatore was showing at the end. So this is our plan for the future, to exploit the result of this project. And that's it. Thank you very much for your attention. Now we are ready to take any question.
Thank you very much. I'll first take questions from here and then we go to Brussels. So, any question on this side?
With these shocked areas you talked, are they static or they can appear dynamically during the simulation?
They can appear dynamically. The user can set the not only the duration, but I forgot to say also the time of appearance. So they can appear randomly or in specific areas at the time specified by the user. So they can perfectly resemble weather events essentially, or military areas.
And how long such kind of a simulation can take?
You mean in terms of computational time? Well, it depends on the number of aircraft involved, mm-hmm. and on the area on which you are working. If you want to start from the beginning, so planning of the trajectories, rectification, and then conflict resolution, it might take a longer time. If you're only talking about conflict resolution, in the model works in time frame of minutes. While, for example, the rectification procedure might be a bit longer, and also making the planned trajectories conflict-free,
it takes time.
That is what is more demanding in terms of computational load, because currently it's done with a brute force algorithm. So you just try every configuration, then you shift in time every trajectory up to the moment in which they are all conflict-free.
Actually, you are working with trajectories, you are not modeling explicitly the aircraft motion.
No, we are not, because we would have needed in that case a specific model for each aircraft.
For each aircraft, yeah. Mm-hmm. Thanks.
You're finding that when the efficiency goes up to what you call the Cesar scenario, then you're basically in a free routing environment, and you're finding that then the number of conflict reduces, but the conflicts are more dispersed over the sector. That seems to largely confirm the research on free routing that has been done in the past. Can you comment on that?
Yeah, essentially, this is what we found out also. The other thing that we found out is that the conflicts are spread in a larger area, but if you increase the look ahead and using what is foreseen that the controllers might have in the future, so a tool for medium-term conflict detection. Essentially, what a controller can do is to deconflict the aircraft when they enter the sector. So essentially, aircraft will receive instructions at the entrance of the sector or the ACC, and then they should be able to fly free. This is essentially probably the added value with respect to what was already known from previous research on free routing.
I think your results do look largely intuitive to me. In other words, there's no major surprises, I don't think. But I think it's more direct routing than free routing, isn't it? I would say.
Yeah, yeah.
But so your thing. And by the way, it looks a lot different from the ELSA 1 debrief we had. I think it's come quite a long way since the outcome of ELSA 1, right? Although I can't remember the details. So you can do, basically, you're looking at Cesar scenario, which I take to be direct routes, more or less. You can look at shocks, and you're doing something on the volcano eruption and stuff like that. What else can you do with your model? Are there any other applications in terms of, introducing new controller tools or integrating UAS into the system or something like that?
Well, in principle, you can, for example, introduce UAS by defining a different entity in the model. So currently we have aircraft, they are all behaving in the same way. And in principle, we can include another entity behaving in a different way, like a UAS.
A slow one that's doing different patterns and stuff like that.
Yeah, exactly. which has some limits in terms of ceiling or speed or whatever. With this model, you can, for example, analyze different airspace configurations. We didn't show anything on this in this presentation, but it's something that can be done. And yeah, of course, the results are pretty intuitive, but the purpose was not really to find something different in the end, but to demonstrate that the model was able to resemble what is expected from Caesar scenario, and so that is something that can be effectively used to model new features, both in the current and in future scenarios.
We can make with the model
policy experiments regarding the different behavior of the airlines. Marco was already showing you that in the strategic layer, the full strategic layer, there is this cost function which allows you to distinguish business airlines and low-cost airlines. But there is also another place in the model when we
have this shuffled list, for example. This is important because, as Marco was saying at the beginning, this is a list of aircraft which is shuffled at each time step. But in the CSR scenario, or even in the current scenario, let's say, we can imagine that there are airlines which are prone to accept trajectory deviations because they don't care about fuel consumption or things like that, because they want to go over no matter what happens, while there are other airlines which they want to stick to the planned trajectory because they have a big fuel consumption constraints, they want to be on time, and these are maybe more on the business airlines. So we can imagine that there will be fees that the airline will have to pay if they want to stick, no matter what happens on the planned trajectory, while there will be less fees for the trajectories which are prone to accept. And we can implement these kind of behaviors in this list, which will not be a shuffled list any longer, because we can put the aircraft of the companies that want to be moved around because they don't care in the first place, and we can move the Alitalia or British or Air France on the bottom part of the list so that they will never have changes. And so we can numerically simulate these kind of behaviors and see what happens. That's another kind of application we can have, for example.
Yeah, kind of a rewarding mechanism in a business trajectory environment.
Economic incentives, optimizing the overall network based on economic incentives. Yes.
Exactly. Well, basically, this idea is something we are proposing for a project under the new call, but we'll see.
Okay, over to Brussels.
Thank you very much for your presentation. I would like, first we start with the questions from Luca, who is our ATM expert. And I would like also to let you know that Hoang has joined us from the European Commission, from DG Move. So he regularly sits at our closeout meetings to hear what are the research results of our project. So I would give the floor to Luca and then Hoang if he has some questions, and then me, okay?
Yes, okay. Go ahead.
Okay, good morning everybody. Given that I was not aware of this ELSA project since maybe last 2 weeks, so I consider myself as an external reader and reviewer of the documents. I have a couple of questions regarding the outcomes and the results. First of all, if and how the model deals with the aircraft performances in terms of speed and similar performances during the conflict resolution. So given a conflict between two or more airplanes in a given null point, is there any reference to the airplane performances?
Well, the reference to the airline, to the performance we have, is what Salvatore showed in this slide that I put on, model calibration. So essentially, the only thing we are considering regarding the aircraft performance is the speed, which is still an average speed between two different nav points. And for each part of the trajectory between two nav points, the speed is kept constant. This is the only thing we consider in terms of aircraft performance. For the rest, for the model, all aircraft are behaving in the same way. So we didn't consider any performance model for the different aircraft types, let's say. But we didn't show it here. There's a model which allows to solve conflicts by changing the velocity. And this module can be tuned by allowing different aircraft to change velocity in a different way, essentially. But the model was not conceived to analyze in a precise way the behavior of the aircraft, but was more conceived to get an overall picture of the whole system. That's why we didn't include aircraft performance models from the beginning.
Okay, my question is only aiming to ensure that any possible deviation or modification or change of the trajectory of a plane given a conflict is consistent with the plane characteristics and performances. This is my just to be sure that somehow taking into account.
Yeah, on average, it is consistent because we are using velocities extracted from real data, but we are considering all aircraft the same. So essentially, there will be for sure deviations from reality. But since our results are looking into, let's say, the average number of conflicts, maybe this number, using the right, let's say, performance models may vary for a really small percentage, but the overall result will probably, I mean, we are sure will be the same also this way.
If we go to this parameter 11, it's a pair of parameters, velocity min and velocity max. This is the minimum and maximum velocity of aircraft present in the ACC, which is then observed from real data and essentially refers to the picture we were showing before on the calibration of the velocity. And so we have a control in the model that when we make a change, the velocity of the aircraft will be within this range. And so this is a way we think will make this new configuration acceptable from a technical point of view of the aircraft. Indeed, if we cannot do rerouting, and if we cannot do flight level changes, or if we cannot solve the conflict by changing the velocities, as Marco was saying before, then there is a further check in the model that starts again from scratch and tries a different list, reshuffles the aircraft in a different list and put this problematic aircraft on top of the others and tries again to do the procedure for the conflict resolution.
Thank you. This is a three-dimensional model, right?
Yes.
So also, the trajectory can change, so the plane can change its flight level, for example, right?
Yes, yes.
Okay, so every plane has a climb rate or a descent rate depending on its own performances. So maybe it is kind of an idea for possible improvements for the future.
Yes, for sure. I mean, but for the moment we concentrated on different aspects, not paying too much attention on these things. But for sure, to make the model more realistic, this is the first thing that needs to be done.
It's okay. Don't misunderstand me.
No. Don't worry. Yes, yes.
That's it.
Thank you for for noticing.
No, nothing. You're very welcome. Concerning the look ahead.
Yes.
I'm looking at slide 36. It seems that, as you say, with a higher or a high look ahead time, this spatial location of the actions is improved, because the areas, the number of areas where actions from controllers are taken decreases.
Yes.
Okay, that's fine. One question, because I see the number of actions increases as well.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe this less number of actions have to be managed by one controller if the spatial location is reduced. What I mean is that having more distributed actions, the same actions can be taken by a higher number of controllers.
Mm-hmm.
If you reduce the number of actions, but also you reduce the area of application of these actions, maybe those actions, even if less in number, should be taken by a single controller. Have you ever, let's say, considered the side effect or possible side effect?
Not in these terms, to be honest. What we considered is that in the situation of the right panel, so higher look ahead, we are expecting the controller or the controllers, I don't know how many there will be in a future scenario, will have access to a tool helping us in deconflicting the flights at the entrance of their area of control. With this tool, maybe even a single controller or a limited number of controllers might be able to deal with all these flights. This is the answer we gave to ourselves. I mean, since the future scenario is not real still, let's say, we can just make a hypothesis on how it will be managed, essentially.
Okay, thank you. I have just a last question. In terms of validation, probably I read somewhere in your papers, but can you tell me how you validated your results with controllers, with real controllers? I mean, how did you interact with them?
For the current scenario, we did that mainly in the first phase of the project. We had small workshops with controllers in which we showed them the results, asking them if what they were seeing was kind of compliant with their work experience. For the Cesar scenario, since there's no controller that have ever managed this kind of scenario, we didn't rely on an air traffic controller, but rather on an ATM expert, which was appointed to the project by SJU, Dr. Feja Netjasov from University of Belgrade. So we had a couple of meetings with him, both in the development phase, so asking him if what we were doing was compliant with his view of the future scenario. And once the results were ready, we presented him the results, asking if what we were obtaining was in line with his expectations and what he thought were the operational benefits of our results. And in fact, the slide about the operational benefits, number 39, is essentially a summary of the feedback we received from him. This concept of safety improvements or improved airspace management was something that was suggested to us by him after looking at our results. So this is regarding the future. Of course, in the model development, there were also other meetings with the controllers of the Rome ACC, to whom we asked, for example, what are their controlling strategies in terms of maximum angle of deviation between planned and a new trajectory, these kind of things. So all parameters that we couldn't derive from real data were instead set according to what these interviews essentially, yes.
Okay, thank you very much. So the current scenario is the current way we fly today, and the Cesar scenario is scenario with this free routing or direct routing or...
Yes. Yes. Yeah, essentially what we are referring to as Cesar scenario in all these slides is essentially free routing and direct routes. But there are other features that we can consider as part of the Cesar scenario, like the increased look ahead or the possibility of making the planet trajectories conflict free, which we consider them as part of the Cesar scenario, but we used as just features to test independently.
Okay, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you. So I have two questions. One is related to the FARC metrics, and particularly it was mentioned that you're developing this metric, and I'm interested to understand what are the potential applications of this metric.
This is something we can see from slide 42, for example. Essentially, the idea of using this FARC metric
is that, let's put it this way. Of course, we know that the planned and realized trajectories are different the one from each other, because the planned trajectories are not conflict-free, because the planned trajectories do not include problems that may arise at the last minute, or they may arise en route, and things like that. Often, if you have a superficial view of these differences, you cannot spot them. In the sense, if you concentrate on simple things like the difference in length, for example, between planned and realized trajectories, you don't see big differences. And you cannot spot differences between night and day. We have done that by looking at the data, directly in the data, okay? What I mean is that you need a metric which goes more on the specific, more at the level of a single navigation point, and tries to spot what are the differences between planned and realized trajectory, not globally, but at the level of a single navigation point, at the level of a single portion of the airspace. In this case, the FARC metric is very good because it spots the differences between planned and realized at a local level, at the level of a single navigation point. And in that case, we can see differences in the air traffic controllers between night and day. We can see that they issue more directs during night than during day, because during day, the traffic is so large that you cannot make many accommodations, while during night you are more free to give directs because you are sure that there are no conflicts. My point is that if you try to look at these behavioral differences in the air traffic controller by looking at globally at the system, it is very difficult to see them, while the FARC metric and the results we have, and we are currently working on these kind of things, the FARC metric goes deep in detail at the level of the single navigation point, and that allows you to spot these differences in the behavior of the controllers. Unfortunately, we could not put everything in these slides, but the preliminary results we have go in this direction.
Okay, thank you. And then my last question is, if you have to summarize the research results of ELSA, can you please summarize them in a few words, and then what are the type of results which, for long-term research, for the future evolution of ATM could be relevant? So from the current results of ELSA, what are the ones which you think, what are the future areas where further research needs to be performed?
You mean the whole project or just the extension?
I mean what you showed today, now you showed the result, the whole project. I mean, this is the closeout of the ELSA project. So what are the findings of your, I mean, through the whole presentation, there were slides, these are the results, just like the top priority three conclusions or three findings of ELSA, and then what are the future, based on these findings, what are the future research areas where you think there needs to be more research performed, but not on building a community around the air traffic simulator. I want, you know, what the concrete ideas for future results, you know.
Okay, yeah, I would say the development of these non-conventional metrics is for sure one of the main and more interesting outcomes of the project. Because these metrics can help in describing the system in a new way, and potentially by linking these metrics to some real events, like for example, you can link the FARC metrics with the occurrence of STCA, for example, let's say. And this kind of analysis can help in understanding what is the relationship between the occurrence of safety events and the behavior of the controllers. Another thing is not the community around the simulator, but the simulator itself. To me, it's something that can be exploited in future research because it can be used. And what we did was to demonstrate that this is actually happening. It can be used to model features that are foreseen in the future. So new research on Cesar can build on this simulator. So if there are new concepts that needs to be tested, that they can be tested using this simulator. So it's something that we deliver to the Cesar community and that can be exploited for sure in the future. I would say these two things are probably those that will be exploited in the future. And as I reported also in the final report, these conventional metrics can be also be analyzed in terms of defining if they are a proxy to identify behavioral patterns. So and once these patterns are identified, the researcher can ask himself what are the drivers behind these patterns, what are the consequences of behaving in a specific way rather than another. And by comparing how controllers are behaving in different areas of the airspace or in different airspace configurations by using, for example, by applying these metrics to the simulator, I think interesting results and interesting research can be carried out.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Any other recommendations for future research based on ELSA?
Well, in terms of lessons learned, the thing I would say for future research is that every project should have access to what we call Cesar experts, so someone that can give advices on what the Cesar will really be, because we really benefited from the presence of Feja and Jasov in this extension. While probably in the first phase we had kind of a problem on really understanding what we should mean by Cesar, what were the things we should have modeled and so on and so forth.
I think the allocation of Fabia to your project was actually I took care of it, but I think the aspect which was very important not to forget that he is an expert. He has a PhD, I think, in agent-based modeling. It's related. He does research in that domain. So that really contributed to immediately capturing the part of the project and understanding it.
Yeah.
And Mark, also we together discussed it, and it was very well accepted that he's the best one for that project. Now, I think from the beginning, from ELSA, from CO1, it was, as ELSA is a CO1 project, and then it was extended. I think already when the project was setting its objectives, it was not very clear, maybe in the beginning, and then it evolved, and the more, you know, with the evolution with the project, you learned also more about Cesar and Cesar concepts and the needs and scenarios and so on. So it's been, let's say, a learning process on both sides.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, we couldn't have had Fabio for a longer time to contribute because it was it's due to other constraints. So, but at least I'm very glad to see that these 3 days helped you on improving the project. Yeah.
Yes, very much. I mean, it's true what you're saying that at the beginning, probably the objectives were not fully clear, but. This is due to the fact that this was a real exploratory research project. I mean, because we were planning to apply some concepts that were coming from the physics domain to the ATM, and this the first time. So,
that's why we granted the extension, because we understood also that you learned that you have to look at the multi-sector level, and so it was. Mm-hmm. Completely understanding on our side that you need a learning process. It's on both sides. Yeah.
Yeah. Of course.
If I can add just a few words, just a few things.
Something we learned really from this project is the need that we have of reliable and available data to work with. That's an issue that for us is crucial. Data on airlines, data on trajectories, metadata on weather events, things like that. For us, it's really crucial to have access to data. I know that there is this SWIM initiative, which is taking place in the ATM world. But my point is that for academic research, because we are a university, for example, for academic research, I think it would be crucial, if we want that these kind of things, the application of a complexity methodology, complex networks, network theory, and complex system, if you want that these methodologies percolate down to the ATM level, it is crucial that data are available to the largest possible community, because we have an experience that we have also done during the preparation of the proposal for the new projects, that data are around, somewhere they are available. In many cases they are commercially available, but in that case they cost a lot, and they are out of reach for a reasonable research project. While I believe that somewhere in Eurocontrol this data must be, and my point is that they should be available to the research community, because that well, I have the example of because we work as a research area in finance and biology. The moment, the very moment in which data became available to the community, because they were electronically recorded and they were so huge in size, but also more easily recordable and things like that, there was a huge amount of research in these fields, because we as a physicist need data, because the model is okay, we do toy model, we do agent-based model, but the basic thing is data, because we have to compare our results with data.
We understand that, and actually I think most probably it's actually not only your project who is raising this issue, it's been raised throughout other projects, the work by DG, and pretty much I believe Mark has very much supported you in getting...
Well, it was Mark, the role of Mark was crucial in this sense, because he made us available a lot of things, so...
has the access to that data. I know this is a major issue, and actually what I wanted to say, I really very much appreciate that for the ELSA project, you're having the model and the similar, like an open source. I think that's very, very important to the research community. And I would like to thank you for considering to do that and actually sharing your knowledge. We are looking at ways to deal with this issue, what you're saying, the data issue. We're trying to find a solution for future exploratory research projects. So we are aware of it, and we haven't forgotten about it, and we're looking for a solution. Okay?
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Anything from Juan?
Any question?
Well, apologies because I came late during the presentation, and I did not follow the project. However, there are a few questions which remains at the general basis, but we can talk on another occasion, but at least you spot the problem of the data availability, for which we are also very sensible on that aspect, and we are trying to address this issue at the European level as well. So in the next couple of weeks to come, a lot of discussion will be focused on the availability of the data. So we are wondering how we can work together, maybe with the commission, between the commission and the different entity in the aviation world in order to at least to centralize, to make it available to the research community. And this is not the first time that we discovered the problematics. And also coming from the university community, I think this is the most important aspect that we need to solve, because you do not have much, how to say it, means and driver to solve that problem. So this is up to us and the relevant organization to solve that.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.